Good morning. I welcome everyone to this, the fifth meeting of the Public Petitions Committee in 2021. This meeting is being held virtually. The convener is unable to attend the first part of our meeting today, but will join us when she is able to. The first item on our agenda is a decision on whether to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Do members agree? That's agreed. Thank you. The second item on our agenda today is the consideration of continued petitions. The first continued petition is PE1662, Improved Treatment for Patients with Lyme Disease and Associated Tick-Borne Diseases, lodged by Janie Crinigan and Lorraine Murray on behalf of Tick-Borne Illness Campaign Scotland. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve testing and treatment for Lyme disease and associated tick-borne diseases by ensuring that medical professionals in Scotland are fully equipped to deal with the complexity of tick-borne infections, addressing the lack of reliability of tests, the full variety of species in Scotland, the presence of persister bacteria which are difficult to eradicate, and the complexities caused by the presence of possibly multiple co-infections, and to complement this with a public awareness campaign. And we have Alexander Burnett, MSP, joining us for this item, so welcome to him. Now, at our last consideration of this petition in December 2020, we agreed to invite the Minister for Public Health and the Chief Medical Officer to give oral evidence. So I'm pleased to welcome today Marie Goujon, the Minister for Public Health and Sport, and in place of the Chief Medical Officer, Dr. Jill Hawkins, the Senior Medical Officer in Health Protection, and Professor Tom Evans, CMO Speciality Advisor in Infectious Diseases. Thank you all for joining us this morning. I invite the Minister to provide a brief opening statement before we move to questions. Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I'm really pleased to be able to be in front of the committee today, because I think it's only right that this matter is taken seriously and that Lyme disease receives this kind of scrutiny. So I know that for some, Lyme disease can have lasting and life-altering impacts, and that's why it's so important that we get the diagnosis, the testing and the treatment right. Now, I'm by no means an expert in this matter, but I do know that one organisation or clinician doesn't have all the answers, and it's through ongoing collaboration and robust evidence gathering and analysis that we hope those answers can be found. And I very much appreciate the role that this committee is playing in that process. And I just want to begin by stating that the Scottish Government and our public health partners are committed to supporting those with Lyme disease, to finding new and better diagnostic and treatment tools, and to really essentially trying to prevent it in the first place. None of those tasks is easy, and I fully understand the frustration of those who feel that progress is too slow or that not enough is being done. However, I just want to reassure the committee that we have world-class lab facilities in Scotland which are working, often with international partners, to ensure that our testing is robust and that it meets the highest standards too. We have a network of public health experts who are dedicated to ensuring that health professionals are aware of the symptoms of Lyme disease and understanding how best to support patients who have or are suspected of having it. Now, like in many other areas, the pandemic has had a huge impact on how much we can progress that work on these matters. And I appreciate that that just adds more frustration to the situation. However, within current constraints, we will do all that we can, and we will do more when pressures ease. I also want to inform the committee that last week I met the petitioner where I emphasised those points and reassured them of that. And in particular, I also want to highlight that we'll be holding a roundtable in the coming weeks that will bring together clinicians, patient representatives and public health experts to discuss this further too. And that was on the back of the suggestion of the petitioners, and it's in keeping with the ideas of collaboration and analysis that I mentioned earlier. So I'm really grateful to the petitioners for suggesting that, and I'm really hopeful that that will help inform what we do next as we go forward. And again, as I'd said previously, I'm not an expert in this field, but I will be guided by the advice of those who are. So I look forward to your questions, and where there is the clinical or public health expertise needed to provide the committee with more clarity on any responses, I have my colleagues Jill and Tom here with me today, who will also be happy to answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That was indeed some positive news. I'm going to start off by asking about Dr. Cruikshank's submission. And in it, she states that 10 to 20% of Lyme disease infections result in persistent symptoms. And she also states that clinicians frequently report a limited understanding of the disease, with some even insisting that chronic Lyme disease does not exist. So it appears that there is a risk that patients are being denied not only NHS treatment, but also compassion from clinicians, some of whom are just outwardly dismissing the concerns. So can you tell me, does NHS Scotland acknowledge the existence of persistent or chronic Lyme disease?
Thank you for that question. I mean, that was one point that came across when I met Dr. Cringin last week, and just that concern about, well, their concerns being dismissed. And I think that's one thing that I would really want to emphasise right from the outset, is that we don't want the concerns of patients to be dismissed by anyone, and no one should be left in the position where they feel like that's the way that they've been treated. I think in terms of your specific point, I think my clinical colleagues would probably be better placed to come in and respond to that. But I would really just want to assure the committee that from a government perspective, we are firmly committed to ensuring as far as possible that patients who are ill get the appropriate treatment to help them recover, and that if the cause of their symptoms is unclear, that we do all we can to try and get to the bottom of that. And again, I just want to give the committee that assurance, but I'll probably bring Tom in to elaborate further on that point.
Professor Evans.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Deputy Convener. Yes, I've worked in Scotland for just over 17 years now in infectious diseases, and I've probably seen and treated hundreds of patients with Lyme disease. I'm well aware of the problems that the petitioners outline. I think there are two areas there. Firstly, what do we know about patients who present with persistent symptoms? How common is that? And secondly, how much are clinicians aware of that, and what are they doing about it? So I think I would say the evidence isn't that there are that many people. And I always preface that by saying that doesn't mean I'm not caring for someone or not wanting to be sympathetic or empathetic. And unfortunately, in this era, we've seen breakdown of communication with doctors and patients, which is hugely regrettable. As the minister says, we all want to help people. That's what we're in it for, and give them the best possible help that we can. These symptoms are common and in the sort of general population. And I think that's where the complications can arise, because population surveys have looked at a variety of symptoms that some of the patients after Lyme say they're suffering from. And actually, those turn out to be quite common and people don't have Lyme disease. So it's a difficult one to get these accurate representations. So, for example, a study done in Slovenia, in East Europe, where there's a lot of Lyme disease, followed nearly 300 patients after Lyme disease with a carefully matched group of controls. And actually, only about 2% of patients in both groups had these sort of symptoms after 12 months. So it's certainly a problem. I'm not denying that. What I'm saying is I don't think it's as big as those figures. The second issue I think is a very important one, and where I think we have common ground with the petitioners in awareness and public understanding of the disease. And I think my personal opinion is certainly more could be done in that area, particularly probably for primary care physicians, some of whom have excellent knowledge of the disease and some for whom they're not well acquainted with it, and likewise in secondary care as well. And we have some initiatives which we'll perhaps come on to later to, I hope, improve that. Perhaps I could ask my colleague, Dr. Jill Hawkins, who works in public health, perhaps to address that second point. Thank you.
Dr. Hawkins?
Hi, thank you. Yes, just to follow up on what Tom was saying, I think there's certainly variation in the degree of knowledge that healthcare practitioners have in certain areas of Scotland where Lyme is maybe more prevalent and GPs see more Lyme, then they're more confident in recognising it, diagnosing and treating it. So I think there's certainly work we can do there around improving awareness with our clinical colleagues, and that's right from our pharmacy to our GPs to our secondary care colleagues. And certainly there has been some work undertaken so far under the work of the Scottish Health Protection Network for Lyme disease, but we can hope to build on that and create even more awareness raising opportunities to continue to get those messages across. I think what's key here is that early recognition, early treatment, and thinking about Lyme disease when maybe I think sometimes that people know a lot about the Lyme rash or the target rash that you see, but just raising awareness about some of the other symptoms or more unusual presentations that maybe GPs that don't have that experience may be more likely to miss. So yeah, I absolutely think there's work there that we could do to improve that that recognition and diagnosis in the early stages when we can treat Lyme. So that would be my main sort of point around where we can go with the awareness raising.
Okay, thank you. Minister, a petitioner state that chronic Lyme patients who pay for private treatment often recover, but these treatments are not available on the NHS. Can you explain to us why that might be the case?
Again, I think this question would probably be more appropriate for my clinical colleagues too, but I would just say, because I don't think it's my place to comment on treatments, and I wouldn't be able to comment on private treatments that are available, but I would just say that the NHS would support patients to manage any symptoms that they're experiencing. And I would even hope that since the petitioners had first developed their symptoms and the duration of that period of time, that the approaches would have already improved throughout that. But again, I'll probably bring in Tom on this point.
Professor Evans.
Thank you, Minister. Deputy Convener. Yes, so two issues here. Firstly, with any treatment that we are offering in the National Health Service, we want to be sure that it's evidence-based and that it's going to do patients good. And that goes not just for Lyme disease, but for any condition. Clinicians will rely on international experience and evidence, and we have the benefit of the National Institute for Clinical Evidence, a UK-based organisation. We have European Centres for Disease Control, and we have the Centres for Disease Control in North America, where obviously Lyme was first recognised, and there's a huge amount of Lyme disease. So there's a large body of international evidence that's looked at treatments and what best can be done for patients who are suffering. In particular, they've looked at a longer term antibiotic treatment, which is something that is very commonly, I think, patients with Lyme ask me, is it going to do me any good if we give me antibiotics for a month or 2 months or 6 months? Very common question. The evidence is that it doesn't. And there have been a number of larger trials that looked at comparing patients who had those antibiotics compared to a placebo in a blinded fashion, so we didn't know which group was which, and then said, well, what was the outcome? And the overwhelming evidence in those larger trials is that the longer term antibiotics didn't offer anything better than the placebo. Both groups showed improvement, but there was no difference if you had the antibiotics or if you didn't. So I think, certainly from my perspective and those of my clinicians, we wouldn't feel that treatment was justified based on the available evidence. It doesn't mean to see there might be more evidence in the future that would support that. We always keep an open mind. So we're lacking, I think, we wouldn't wish to give patients longer term antibiotics on the current available evidence. And indeed, I personally have seen in patients, one of my patients who received longer term antibiotics had a serious reaction to them. So this isn't something that's entirely risk-free. So we do have to make sure we get that balance of risk and harm correct. I think where I think there is definite room for improvement is in those who have these longer term symptoms who are clearly suffering, and in terms of what treatment we could offer them. And I think that's where we're really lacking evidence. And I think NICE, the European Centers for Disease Control, and the American IDSA guidelines have all acknowledged that that's an area where more research is certainly needed. And indeed, shades into other areas in chronic fatigue syndrome. And of course, more recently, we're seeing patients who, after COVID, are experiencing longer term symptoms. And I think whether these have similar underlying causes, whether the treatments will be one will work for all groups or whatever, we don't honestly know. But it's certainly, I think, an area where we do need some better evidence to see how best we can help those people. But certainly currently, antibiotics and some of the other treatments that are offered privately, to the best of my knowledge and evidence, those are not something that we could recommend currently. So I hope that helps and sets out where we think what we can do and what perhaps we need to know. Jill, I don't know if you want to add anything from a public health perspective.
Dr. Hawkins?
Yeah, I think I would say certainly the views Professor Evans have expressed are in keeping with those for the clinical experts that have been advising the Scottish Health Protection Network around education, awareness raising, and other elements of the clinical aspects of treatment of Lyme disease. I think there needs to be again awareness though that amongst the clinical profession around longer term symptoms, and that people do have these longer term symptoms and do need to have support and management of those symptoms. Now that might, there may be debate about the antibiotics, but there isn't debate about the need to provide holistic care to people who have long-term symptoms and make sure that they are being addressed and taken seriously and they feel they're being supported. So again, that's an area where we hope awareness raising will improve the patient experience going forward when they do have those longer term symptoms that some do unfortunately suffer from.
Thank you. Maurice Corey.
Thank you, Deputy Greener. Good morning, Minister and panel. Chronic Lyme disease, the multi-system infection requiring multiple specialities and specialties, but there are currently no specialist multidisciplinary treatment centres around. And consequently, patients can receive an uncoordinated and ineffective care. Do you agree with the calls to establish a multidisciplinary treatment centre service for the evaluation, support and management of patients with chronic and persistent symptoms of tick-borne infections? And Minister, maybe you'd like to start that one off.
Minister.
Thank you. Yes, well, this was actually an area of work that prior to the pandemic we'd been looking at. So in terms of perhaps establishing an infectious diseases managed clinical network. So the aim with that would be to bring together health practitioners, other professionals who are involved in caring for patients with infectious diseases. And a proposed work stream within that would be one for Lyme disease as well. But I would emphasise that all of that had been at the very early stages prior to the pandemic. But I think that would be a really important piece of work that we'd be looking to continue, because that brings together everyone that's involved in providing specialist care for particular groups of patients that have complex healthcare needs. So it'd be health and other professionals, patients, carers, their families, and voluntary groups too. So unfortunately, those plans did have to be put on hold because of the pandemic. But I think that there's definitely still a strong appetite for that network, and the Scottish Government will definitely be continuing to support that work when the public health pressures ease.
Right. Maybe Professor... Sorry, Tom Evans might just make a comment.
Professor Evans?
Yes, thank you. So I absolutely recognise the frustration that many patients feel about the multiple referrals that often they have to experience. They see specialist A, they see specialist B, and they feel not listened to. They feel there isn't a joined up view of the problems that they're suffering from. And again, that's sad, because we always want the NHS to be working to the best of its ability, that's clearly not ideal. I think what the Minister has outlined is certainly what we hope we can establish moving forward in what we call a managed clinical network, which brings together specialists in infectious diseases across Scotland to be sure that wherever you live in Scotland, that you get appropriate treatment and access appropriately. And that may... I'm not involved in making policy in this area, but I don't think that's going to be one size fits all. What might work in Central Belt probably isn't going to work in the more remote and rural areas of Scotland. So I think it would take some looking at. But certainly I think bringing together the group of doctors who are most likely to see these patients and to formulate ways in which they can be sure that those referrals you're passing one off to another and one off to another, that could be done much more effectively. And I think Dr. Hawkins can certainly speak a little bit more about the managed clinical network and how that would help.
Thank you. Dr. Hawkins?
Yes, Managed clinical networks are used in a number of clinical areas, and as Professor Evans says, their aim is to bring together individuals with expertise, but from multidisciplinary in a multidisciplinary way. So it's not just the infectious disease physician, but it might be rheumatologists or cardiologists or other specialist clinicians in the hospital that have a role in managing Lyme, but also GPs and maybe other professionals that can help around more of the support rehabilitation elements of Lyme management for those with longer term symptoms. So it's making sure that all those individuals who may be involved in the care of somebody with Lyme are joined up, are providing a joined up service, that the pathway for that individual is as we would want it to be, and as Professor Evans says, not feeling that they're being pushed around from pillar to post, but can have a sort of joined up, wrapped up, holistic approach to their care. The added benefit of the MCN model is that it also brings in patients and their families in terms of informing that. So that's an added benefit there, so that's informing what the work of the MCN is doing. I think the point Professor Evans made about one size fits all is important. I think the aim of our network rather than a specialist service clinic per se is that you can have treatment that's near the patient in the way that works for them, rather than having to travel miles to a central clinic, for example. So, and certainly, again, the views of our clinical colleagues and other colleagues that we are speaking to around Lyme diseases at that Infectious Diseases Managed Clinical Network would be a good way to start to bring all those people together and reduce the variation that we're maybe seeing in people's patients' experience across Scotland.
Thank you. Maurice Corey?
No, thank you for that. Thank you, Deputy Premier. Yes, that was very interesting. And I like the comment Dr. Jill Hawkins just now about bringing people together. And I think that's important because the stories I hear from people who have been affected by this it sort of manifests itself in different ways. And there's also the psychological way of side of it too. So I'd hope you would include some sort of psychologists in your multidisciplinary centres and treatment. I think that's very important because obviously it affects the quality of life. But on that comment, if you'd like to come back to me on that, that's on the psychological side. I'd be very helpful, Minister.
Yes, thank you. Just to say, I mean, that's where, again, the work in developing that was at a very early stage, and we want to pick that up. And of course, we would be considering any possible relevant expertise that should be part of that group as well. And I should also add that when I met with Dr. Crittenden last week too, I mean, that was a point that came across really strongly, just in terms of what Tom and Jill were talking about as well, just in terms of people feeling like they've been passed from pillar to post, which of course you don't want anyone to experience that or feel that that's the way they're being treated. And that's where I see the Infectious Diseases Managed Clinical Network as being key in bringing some of that together. So again, that's a piece of work that we're really keen to progress.
Thank you, Deputy. That's fine. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to your witnesses. The NICE guidelines acknowledge that chronic infection is not yet researched thoroughly enough to support evidence-based guidelines. The NICE guidance that is in place only concerns acute Lyme disease and is based on pure quality evidence, according to Dr. Cruikshank. Does the Minister share the committee's concern that this is an area that requires much more research?
Minister.
Well, I think generally, I mean, clinicians will and they should follow evidence-based guidelines like those that have been produced by NICE. But of course, I think it's probably the case with all diseases that over time we build up more evidence and that informs how those diseases are diagnosed and treated. And I expect that we would continue to build our evidence base. I mean, in previous responses, as I was just talking about the managed clinical network, I think that will go a long way towards that too. There's also the Scottish Lyme disease and tick-borne infection reference laboratory too. So I think there's a number of pieces of work that really will help develop and build that evidence and research base. But I don't know whether Tom or Jill have anything further to add to that too.
Professor Evans, I think you touched on this in one of your previous answers. Would you like to state anything for this question?
No, thank you. Broadly, I'd agree. I think that, there certainly is a room for better evidence, quality evidence, particularly those who are suffering from longer term symptoms for whom currently we don't have any particularly good evidence base to offer them specific treatments. So, yes, I do agree with that. I think, as in any research, it requires initiatives from those who are best placed to do it. I think in terms of, you know, we have ways of funding research in Scotland, in the United Kingdom and Europe. You apply for money to do the research and so forth. So I think I'd certainly I would wish to see more of that done. Obviously, that has to be in an envelope of funding for research in all areas. And that, you know, you have to compete then with others who are wanting to research into other conditions and so forth. There's some very high quality work done on a very small scale. Colleagues in veterinary medicine do a lot on survey of wild animal and farmed animal populations in terms of the range of pathogens they contain. There's good research done by the Public Health Scotland and Public Health England on where ticks are. We have a process of people can send in a tick if they find it, and it gets identified and they're told, and that helps us bring up a map. And there's actually an app being developed through the University of Aberdeen in collaboration with the European Space Agency that will use geospatial locations that people can put in where they found a tick and so forth to build up a better picture. These are small steps, and I would acknowledge that. So, but I think it is an area where we would all wish to have better evidence. And certainly, if there were anything that could be done to support that, I would certainly feel that would be a good idea.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. You mentioned the lack of research here. Can I ask if the Scottish Government is going to do anything to improve research, or, and Tom mentioned that the lack of money there, will they increase funding to look into Lyme disease?
Minister?
Again, with the pieces of work that we're looking at in relation to the looking at the managed clinical network, the other pieces of work that are ongoing that I mentioned in previous responses to, I think all of that will help build the evidence and research base as well. I mean, Tom talked there about other competing priorities, and obviously, like we would do it in other areas, we have to balance this up and look at it. But this is certainly an area that we want to make progress on, and we'll look at those research and evidence gaps and see what work we can take forward in response to that too. But that's where, in my opening statement as well, I talked about that the roundtable that we'll be taking part in, and I think that that'll be a good place to talk about with the further work that we do, what we can do in the short term, what we can do in the longer term, whether that's around awareness campaigns or what gaps or other areas we need to focus on.
David Torrance?
No further questions, Convener.
Thank you. Tom Mason?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning, Professor, and good morning, Doctor. The National Lyme and Tick-Borne Disease Reference Laboratory, ISO accreditation testing available for only 5 strains out of 300 of the Borrelia strain. And our evidence shows that cases can be missed based on when tests are taken. Professor Lambert has called for testing of all co-infections to be established, to improve testing for Lyme disease does not rely on antibody response alone. What is your view on this?
Minister.
Now, I understand that testing is an area that the petitioners have some concerns about, and I know that there are, I mean, I'll probably again bring in my clinical colleagues to discuss this and give more of a substantive answer to this point. But I also understand that I think there's issues around credibility of some of the other testing that's available. But again, in previous responses, I'd referred to the Scottish Lyme Disease and Tick-Borne Infection Reference Laboratory, and I think that that's where the work that they do is really important. So, I mean, they gained their reference laboratory status a couple of years ago, and that's really important for a number of reasons. Because first of all, it means that testing across Scotland can be standardised as far as possible, and it ensures that the lab is centrally funded. And I know that they're involved in an Interreg project at the moment called NorthTick, which is working with 7 other countries, and it's a 3.5-year project. And that is looking at I think a specific part of that work is looking to develop a diagnostic test that would allow current infections from Lyme disease to be distinguished from past infection. So I think all of that work will be really important as we go forward. But again, I'm by no means an expert in this area, and that's where I'll bring in Tom to see if he has anything further to add to that point.
Professor Evans.
Thank you, Minister. Yes, so we are fortunate to have an accredited reference laboratory in Scotland, which means that for clinicians, this is a much easier way of accessing tests. There are other tests offered for these sorts of infections by the Rare and Imported Pathogens Lab, which is a division of Public Health England based down in Portland Down in Salisbury Plain. But it's much, much better that we have this facility in Scotland, particularly because we have a much higher incidence of Lyme disease in Scotland than they do in southern England. I don't want to get too technical. The tests, again, are based on what the evidence shows us as to what the likely infections are and to be sure that we're detecting them. There are a range, as the physicians say, of different species of Lyme disease, the Borrelia bug. And its terminology becomes ever more confusing, even for me who works in the field. So it is something of a nightmare. But they have well-validated tests to cover the species that are thought to be prevalent in Scotland. And indeed, there was a nice study done in 2014 of over 2,000 ticks collected across Scotland in many different locations, 124 of which were positive for different species of Lyme. And they then used molecular testing to say, well, what were those different species? And actually, they found that the ones that they found were exactly those that for tests for which are available using the antibody test. So I don't think we're missing clinically significant cases of Lyme disease. And I should just add in passing, the species that are found of Borrelia in Scotland are quite distinct from those in North America and much more aligned to what we see in Europe. So there is a difference there, and that's important. As far as other pathogens go, we do have molecular tests for some of the other known tick-borne infections, particularly anaplasma, which is found in ticks across Europe. We don't have as much information in Scotland, and that's probably maybe something that we could have a little better of evidence base. But the disease it produces is quite distinctive, quite different from Lyme. And there are we are able to diagnose that using molecular testing. And I've seen one case of that in Scotland, but from a patient actually acquired it on the east coast of America. So there is knowledge there. But again, as Jill and the minister said, better understanding and primary knowledge of that would be certainly welcome. And then there are some other much more unusual infections. Bartonella is, again, I don't want to get too technical, but has been suggested as something found in ticks. But again, international evidence suggests that this isn't something that can be acquired by humans from a tick bite. So I think I would have confidence in what the laboratory is offering in Scotland. I think the clinicians there are always looking at the evidence and always adapting their tests and so forth to be sure they're offering the very best for patients in Scotland. And yes, we keep an open mind, and as things develop and we get more evidence, I'm sure that they will take that on board. So I don't know if, Julie, if you wanted to add anything to that.
Dr. Hawkins?
Thanks, Tom. I think it's just to reinforce what you've just said, that really the important development in recent years has been the reference laboratory status that the National Laboratory now has, because it brings, again, a confidence around the tests that are being used, that those have been validated, that they are the most up-to-date tests that are available and are internationally recognised as the tests that we should be using. I think it's also important to flag up that part of a reference laboratory's function is to develop their testing, and take part in research. As we've already heard, they are actively involved in the North Tick project, a research project which is looking at different diagnostic techniques, and it's very important that any of those techniques that are taken into the reference laboratory are properly validated, and we are sure that they are reliable and are not causing harm by giving false results or questionable results. So I think the reference lab status is something that's very important and something that we obviously will build on, as Tom says, as research evidence comes on board, as we have more tests developed, then the reference lab will be at the forefront of making sure that we appropriate those are used in Scotland. I think it's also worth saying that the reference lab is working closely in collaboration with experts, particularly, as Tom mentioned, in the PHE Rare Imported Pathogens Laboratory, who also have a lot of experience in tests for not just Lyme, but other tick-borne diseases. So that's a very active collaborative relationship that they have there. So I think we can have confidence in that as well.
Bob Mason?
No, no further questions at this point.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Evidence received by committee indicates that a majority of GPs lack experience or confidence in providing advice on tick avoidance, managing tick bites or diagnosing the treatment for Lyme disease. And chronic Lyme patients have been dismissed by infectious disease consultants, unable to help them because of a lack of knowledge. What action has been taken to ensure that all healthcare professionals understand the effects of persistent Lyme disease, the sensitivity of a test for Lyme disease, the importance of adequate treatment and how to treat chronic Lyme disease?
Minister.
Thank you. I mean, again, that's a point that had been raised with me when I met Dr. Cringin, and I think it's just really disappointing to hear that people feel that they've been dismissed or there is a lack of knowledge or understanding there. But I think that's where from responses that Jill and Tom had given previously. I mean, I think that we all know, I think there's more scope there for more awareness raising to be done. And I think that's where the Scottish Health Protection Network, they've done a lot of work in that area in terms of awareness raising. But that doesn't mean that we're sitting back and we don't want to do anything else about it. And that's where the round table that we're due to hold, I think, will go a long way to establishing the next steps that we take in relation to that. Because I think that in areas where there has been high incidence of Lyme disease occurring, GPs might have general awareness, but I think it's not something that can just be seen as one particular area's issue or a rural issue in particular. And I think it's something that there needs to be that general awareness of, particularly as we are, I mean, obviously we want to encourage people to go outdoors and to experience the outdoors and to keep physically active as well. And I think we've seen a big upsurge in that, especially through the course of the pandemic last year. We want to continue to encourage people to go outdoors. So we need that general awareness all around. I think it may have been Jill that touched on that point earlier. We need a greater increased public awareness of even just the measures that people can take to protect themselves against ticks when they're out and about. We also need that awareness amongst primary care, but we also need that in secondary care as well, so that hopefully it doesn't occur all that often. But we don't want people feeling like they're being passed from pillar to post. So I think there are a few different areas of work there where, again, we're not sitting back and not doing anything about it. We recognise more can be done, and I see the round table is an important meeting so that we can start to take that work forward.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you mentioned about in the round table, but GPs are the gatekeepers. If people affected by Lyme disease cannot get past that, how do we improve communications with GPs, an educational programme with them about Lyme disease? But also, is the Scottish Government going to run a national campaign during the highlight of it, when it is the high season for ticks, just making public awareness about Lyme disease?
Minister?
Yes, absolutely. We'll be committing resources to that, to resource that, to support the education and awareness raising around Lyme disease. And again, at that round table, that's where I want to get the advice and speak to experts, patients, to work with us on how best we do that. And David Torrance raises an important point, which I touched on earlier as well. I think, again, this is about public awareness and how we do that. It is also about that primary care awareness as well. There will be a lot of GPs where there is that awareness, but again, that's where the Scottish Health Protection Network and the tick-borne disease subgroup that they have there, they've been doing a lot of work in that area and providing educational resources for professionals, as well as trying to engage outdoor organisations as well. But again, we are keen to take forward that work, and that's why we will be committing resources to it and taking that forward later this year.
Maurice Corey.
Deputy Convener, thank you for that. Yes, my colleague has just answered some of the points that I was going to raise, but if I could sort of dig a bit deeper into this public awareness of the disease and the tick-borne infections, what specifically can the Scottish Government do and the medical profession in ensuring that people know how to recognise and safely remove ticks and to know what to look for as far as symptoms are concerned after the bite? Maybe Minister.
Yeah, that's where, I mean, I'm not able to outline the specifics of what any education campaign will consist of at the moment, purely because that's why we want to have the round table to discuss with the people who have suffered this, as well as the clinical experts as well, to get everyone around the table to see, right, okay, well, what are the messages we need to get across? And look at the best way that we can try and do that. So I think it's really important we do that as a first step to make sure that we have that collaboration and that analysis as well as we try to progress that work. And that's why I say, you know, we've committed resource to this. This is a piece of work that we are going to do, but we want to make sure that we get all of that right. And that's where meeting with that round table and seeking that collaboration and that advice is a really important step forward.
Thank you, Minister. Yeah, thank you, Minister. Would the others like to make comment on that?
Professor Evans?
No, thank you. So, yes, I would echo the views about the need, as the Minister was saying, the need to be sure that we have a more even and better understanding, knowledge and for both primary and secondary care physicians across Scotland. Absolutely. Of the patients I see, it's clear that some primary care physicians have a fantastic understanding and knowledge of the disease and treat the patients that they see extremely well, whereas others really don't, through no fault of their own, but they just don't understand or even have heard of the disease particularly. So I'm sure that there is room for improvement there. And the other thing I would say is we need to encourage people to go out. Anything else we've learned over the last year is the importance for mental health and well-being of the countryside and enjoying what Scotland has to offer, and that's really important. There are other public health messages, not just about ticks, that are important about being in the countryside. And I think Jill will touch on those as well. But also that I live in the middle of Glasgow, but you don't have to go very far to find a tick. Where my dog walks up at Mugduck Park, it's bristling with ticks. And so it's not just in the more remote and rural areas that we see this, but also in the bigger cities as well. So I think that's it's probably there that clinicians probably have much less experience because they're not used to seeing it. So I think definitely room for improvement. And I think I'd echo all the Minister's comments there about what we can do moving forward.
Dr. Hawkins?
Yes, just to build on what's been said, I mean, there has been work under the network developing resources. There's been work working in partnership with NHS Inform to get information onto the NHS Inform website. And there's a specific site there called the Outdoor Bugs and Germs site that gives advice around Lyme disease, but not only Lyme, but other infections you might encounter when out about in the countryside. So I think that the initial work has been done about developing those resources. The next key stage is how we get the reach and how we get that out there so that people who need to see that information see it and see it in a way that it's before they get to the countryside, they become prepared, it becomes part of what you do when you get out and about, take your sun cream, you take your water, you take your tick remover, you know how to look out for ticks, how to check and what to do if you have a tick bite, how to safely remove the tick. And even beyond that, how to look out for symptoms and present to your GP if you feel unwell. So the key here, I think we've got we know the messages, we've got the materials, it's how we get that out there. And again, the roundtable hopefully will help with that and drawing on that experience and expertise of others to help us to do that will be very important.
Thank you. Tom Mason, I know that you had a question about the Minister being willing to engage with the petitioners, but we've heard that she already has. So would you like to just follow that up, please, Tom?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Yes, Minister, you quite very kindly outlined what you had engaged with petitioners and your engagement with research and so on and round tables. I think what is most important in this whole discussion is how this whole situation will be taken forward. So can you firm and firm your program for engagement over the next period, years, months, whatever, and whether that will be sustained. And because it was, in order to resolve all of this, this engagement really has to go on for many years, I guess.
Minister.
I mean, you're right. This is it's a complex problem, and there isn't, unfortunately, there's not one solution that's going to solve it. And I think that's where that ongoing engagement is really important. And we want to make sure any messages we go out, just as Jill was talking about, that we do that in the right way and in the most effective way. So and that's where it was a really positive meeting that I had with Dr. Cringin last week, where we discussed a lot of these issues. And again, that's where the suggestion for the roundtable came from, so that we could bring all the relevant people together and discuss how we move forward. So I don't just see that as being a tick box exercise that we will have had the roundtable and that's the end of the work. I very much see that as a start in the process of bringing all the relevant people together, because I think it is going to be really important. And especially, like I say, we've committed resource to doing more of an awareness campaign later in the year. So we will want to continue that engagement as far as possible, and to make sure that any messages we put out, we're doing that in the right and the most effective way.
Thank you. Maurice Corey with a quick supplementary, and then I'll bring in Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, David Peter. On the 31st of October this year, Professor Lambert states in his submission that, however, that the antibody test misses many cases of Lyme disease, and he has therefore called for a review of current testing strategies. Would you all agree with that? And Minister, to kick off.
Minister?
Yeah, again, I think when it comes to testing, I'm probably better handing over to my clinical colleagues in relation to that. But, you know, as we've talked about previously, there's work being done by the Scottish Lyme Disease and Tick-Borne Infection Reference Lab in relation to that. But again, I'll hand over to Tom.
Professor Evans. Professor Evans, we've still got your microphone off. That's you now. Thank you.
Sorry about that. I would echo my previous comments on testing. The reference laboratory follows best international practice on what the evidence base shows us are the tests that work, that are the most reliable. It is constantly under review, as the Minister outlined, and they take on board the best possible evidence at the time. So I wouldn't agree with the petitioners that the testing is inadequate in the way they outline. But that's not to say that we won't constantly keep it under review. I think that's really the key message I wanted to get across.
Thank you. Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I kind of thank the Minister and Dr. Hawkins and Professor Evans for coming along today and answering questions. I think it's very important, you know, particularly for petitioners, that, you know, whilst the pandemic goes on, that other subjects aren't being ignored, and particularly this one, which has been going on for some time. Also thank the Minister for meeting with certainly with Janie. I don't know if she met with both petitioners. She can correct me if I'm wrong. I believe the other petitioner is one of her constituents, and certainly is well publicised caught Lyme within her constituency, and not up on the high ground, but you know, down on the coast, to just show that it can be caught anywhere across Scotland. My question, well, I've got two questions and one point which we might like to come back on. But the first question is really one of process again, following on from what Tom Mason was saying, and thanking the Minister for holding the round table. Can I ask how that round table, what will the format of that be in terms of you know, the sessions? You know, can I suggest perhaps Professor Lambert's he's got six areas, which sort of break it down so that you do get proper dialogue in detail on each part. But my real question around the roundtable is, what comes out of that? What is the process for something coming out of that roundtable? I think we've had so many sort of talking shops of people discussions, but it's never clear to the petitioners, especially, what the process is that results from a roundtable. So I don't know if a minister can maybe set out how the roundtable will feed into future deliberations and policy, and how she would respond to that roundtable. So that's my first question. Thank you.
Alexander, can I ask you just to ask both questions together in the interest of time, please?
Yeah, okay, certainly. Okay, the second one was a point which had a bit of a criticism, I'm afraid. And I heard from Dr. Hawkins, especially today, talking a lot about raising awareness. The ministers mentioned raising awareness multiple times. I think the petitioners and other people with Lyme are probably quite sick of hearing that this is what's going to happen, because we've been hearing about raising awareness for years now, and it's simply not substantiated by the evidence on the ground in terms of government performance, in terms of publication and awareness, and particularly, as the minister pointed out, we're encouraging more people to go and exercise outdoors. So that's a point which I might like to come back on. And the third point, which is a question, my final point, Deputy Convener, is again around the continuation of how we take this issue forward. And one of the main criticisms has been the lack of patient representation within the subject. And that's well documented in the evidence given. So can I ask the minister how that patient representation will actually materialise? Because at the moment, you know, we're having to come forward with a petition. I don't know what happens to the petition after today. It's very much a cry for help for those who have Lyme's, and the fact they have a lack of a voice. And so in the interest of just keeping this live going forward after the petition, can the minister confirm how patient representation will happen? Thank you.
Thank you. Minister, 3 points for you there.
Yeah, I think I've got a note of them all, so I will try and cover them. I mean, in terms of patient representation and lack of a voice, I mean, I see that as being absolutely critical, and not just in the area of Lyme disease, but in all other aspects of my portfolio. One thing that I'm keen to do is engage with people. I want to hear about people's experience and to hear that from them directly. That's why I was keen to meet with the petitioner last week. And I know that was a point that Alexander Burnett had raised about whether I was able to meet both petitioners. Unfortunately not. I met Dr. Cringin because of the timing of the meeting. I don't think that was suitable for everyone to attend, but I see that as a really key element of my role, which is why I want to engage and why I see the role of that roundtable as being important. Now, I hope that members would be understanding in the fact that, you know, we just had that meeting last week. I've obviously got appearing before you today. So in terms of the arrangements, what the format of that roundtable is going to be, I can't give you that detail as yet because it hasn't been established. But that's where it will be key, because it brings forward that patient voice. The petitioners will be there. We'll have the clinical expertise there as well. And that's where we really want to tease out a lot of these issues. You know, we're all going into it open-minded, not prejudging. I mean, I genuinely want to hear about people's experience, about what we can do, about the messaging, how we can make sure that messaging is effective. And I can't be any clearer than I've already said today. We've committed resource to it. We will be doing that public awareness raising. So I've given that commitment today, and I can assure you that that will happen. But we want to inform that as much as possible, and that's where this work is really important. So I understand that, you know, the concerns that might have been raised by petitioners in terms of, you know, there's been a lot of talking and not a lot of action. Again, I'm fairly new in this post, and I can only do what I can do and what I've said. I'm set out what I'm going to do. And I'd be happy to keep the committee updated on that work as well.
Thank you, Minister. Alexander Burnett, would you like to come back in very briefly?
Very briefly. It was really on the last point. It wasn't so much on the patient representation. It wasn't so much meeting with the minister, for which we're obviously very grateful for. It was patient representation on the actual body mentioned within some of the evidence. Sorry, the name escapes me for a second, but there's a specific body which deals with it, which doesn't have a patient representative from Scotland. And I wonder if just specifically if the minister could address that. That's my final point. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister.
I don't know if that is referencing a point that had been highlighted in previous evidence. And I think my predecessor had actually written to the committee with further information on that towards the end of October. I mean, obviously, I mean, in terms of my engagement, I want to make sure that we have patient representation and patient involvement. Of course, there are some groups in some areas where that's not always going to be appropriate. I think where there's clinical discussions or clinical conversations, I think that, you know, there is an appropriate place for that, but that's not necessarily in some of the groups that we may have talked about today. But If the member wants to write to me with more specific details on that concern, then I'm more than happy to look into that and get back to them.
Thank you, Minister. That's us at the end of our evidence session. I want to thank the Minister and also Professor Evans and Dr. Hawkins for the very thorough evidence today. We now have to decide what we're going to do with the petition going forward. And as Alexander Burnett has already suggested, I think it would be very difficult for us to close this petition at the moment, given that there are so many outstanding issues. And given that the Scottish Government have committed to quite a lot of actions that I think we probably need to keep an eye on, I would suggest that we continue this petition and put it in our legacy paper for the committee that's going to come after us, along with a suggestion to seek assurances and updates from the Scottish Government to address any issues that have been brought up during this session. But I'll go to members quickly for their opinions. Maurice Corey.
Yes, I agree with you. I would wish to continue this petition. There's too many doors open still, and some questions still to be answered. And I think it's important that we see that the government, the Scottish Government, does deliver on the actions that it's said it would do. So therefore, I would request that we continue the petition. Obviously, it is one for the legacy paper as well, and I agree entirely, Deputy Convener, on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom Mason.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I agree with what's been said so far. There's going to be a change of government as we go forward, and therefore legacy papers will carry over the issues that need to be followed up in future years. I expect this still to be on the cards for at least 5 years before it's anything's really resolved on an ongoing basis, which doesn't need detailed scrutiny. Thank you.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with you and my colleagues that we should keep the petition open and take it forward just to see what progress has been made by the Scottish Government. Thank you.
Thank you. And Alexander Burnett, would you like to come in?
Yeah, thank you very much, Deputy Convener, and thank you for you and your committee for that decision today. I think that would be greatly appreciated by the petitioners. It is very much still a live subject, so that's much welcomed. And just as this will probably be the final petition that I appear on in front of you regarding Lyme disease in this session of Parliament, can I just thank you and your committee for your time on this and your interest and for keeping this petition alive on behalf of myself and the petitioners. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'd like to thank you for coming along. Your input has been really important, and thanks to the petitioners as well. So based on our discussion, I think we are going to continue this petition, include it in the legacy paper for the successor committee, along with the suggestion to seek an update from the Scottish Government on any progress made to address the issues raised during the evidence session. Are we all agreed on that course of action, committee members? We are. I would like to suspend the meeting now to allow our other witnesses and the convener to rejoin us. Again, I would like to thank all our witnesses today, and I suspend until 10:35.
Thank you. And the meeting is reconvened, and I'm very pleased and convened as part of the meeting, and thank Gail Ross for convening the earlier session. The second continued petition is petition 1804, Halt Highland and Islands Airports Limited's Air Traffic Management Strategy, lodged by Alison McKechan, John Doig and Peter Henderson on behalf of Benbecula Community Council. And can I welcome Roger Grant MSP and Liam MacArthur MSP for this session. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to halt Highlands and Islands Airport Limited's Air Traffic Management Strategy project to conduct an independent assessment of the decisions and decision-making process of the ATMS project. At our December 2020 consideration of this petition, we agreed to take evidence from representatives of Highlands and Islands Airport Limited, Transport Scotland and the Cabinet Secretary for Transport Infrastructure and Connectivity for future meetings. The committee took evidence from HIAL at our meeting last week, and I am pleased to welcome the Cabinet Secretary, Michael Masterson MSP, today, as well as Gary Cox, Head of Aviation at Transport Scotland. And may I invite the Cabinet Secretary to provide a brief opening statement before we move to questions.
Thank you, Convener, for the opportunity to appear before the committee this morning. I know that HIAL appeared before the committee last week and covered a number of technical aspects relating to the project itself. I think that it's a key point that we need to remember when discussing this particular project is that it is about the continuation of air services in the medium to long term, which in turn helps to secure the economic prosperity of remote and rural communities. The cessation of air services would have a devastating impact on these communities, and we have a responsibility to act now to ensure their continuation. Failure to do so stores up problems and risks connectivity and resilience. HIAL have identified the risks that need to be addressed to ensure the continuation of services. As they said out last week, these include issues such as the need to improve resilience, staff recruitment and retention, the need to modernise working practices, a changing regulatory picture, which started under ESA and is likely to continue under the Civil Aviation Authority, and an opportunity to significantly improve upon current safety levels. This is not a new project. Work on this issue first started in 2015. HIAL commissioned an independent study by the specialist aviation consultancy Helios to advise on the best approach to address the issues that they were facing. The decision to proceed was taken by the HIAL board in January 2018, and implementation of the project has continued since then. HIAL undertook an extensive amount of research in considering numerous options for how to address issues that they face. This included engagement with their staff and other stakeholders, and that engagement will continue through to the programme being completed. HIAL have determined that the strategy that is being pursued is the one that addresses all of the issues that they are facing. Consequence of this strategy is that a number of posts across the HIAL airports will need to transfer to the new surveillance centre in Inverness. HIAL recognised from the outset that this is a significant change process that needs to be carefully managed. That's why they have continued to engage with their staff and stakeholders to develop mitigations for the impacts that it will have on individual airports. Examples of this include commuting policy, which they are developing in consultation with the unions, and the recent announcement of the Centre of Excellence in Benbecula, which, if successful, could see staff from all over the Highlands and possibly from further afield training in Benbecula. HIAL will continue to explore all opportunities to mitigate the transferring of posts to Inverness and to support the economic development of the communities that they are facing. I want to address some issues around the financing of this project because I think it's important to distinguish between the budget that was agreed for the project and other cost figures that have been referenced at various points. I believe there has been some confusion in some quarters on this point, and I'm therefore providing clarity on these issues here today. There is only one approved budget for this project. That is £48.4 million and was approved by the Transport Scotland's Investment Decision Making Board in December 2019. This is made up of £34.7 million of capital budget, as referenced by HIAL in their appearance last week, and £13.7 million in revenue budget. The report undertaken by Helios provided an initial proposal that then evolved into the business case that was approved. It's misleading to say that costs have increased between the initial proposal and the approved business case, as the two are not comparable. And while there have been various figures reported in the media elsewhere, the budget remains £48.4 million as approved in December 2019, and it includes £6.8 million of contingency, which is normal for major infrastructure projects. As is the case with all projects, the scope of the project and estimated cost of different elements have developed over time as more information becomes available and options are refined. Again, as with any infrastructure project, costs will be carefully monitored through the ATMS Programme Board and the HIAL Board and the Independent Audit Programme within the Scottish Government. While still at an early stage, the project is proceeding in line with its approved business case and its budget. And I'm more than happy to respond to any questions that committee members may have, convener.
Thank you very much for that. We will take questions, but I want to take Liam McCassar first.
Thank you very much indeed, convener. Can I also offer my apologies to yourself, convener, members, and to the Cabinet Secretary that I need to duck away early. I have a meeting with the Justice Secretary at 11 o'clock, so I will stay as long as I can, but apologies for that. And can I thank you, convener, and colleagues for the very robust and thorough way in which you've been dealing with this petition. It's an issue that myself, Rhoda, and certainly a number of my constituents have been living and breathing for a number of years now. As the Cabinet Secretary intimated in his opening remarks, it's been ongoing since 2015 and has really come into sharper focus since 2018, the Board's decision. I was interested in the Cabinet Secretary's clarification on the budget issues because, frankly, HIAL have been wholly unable in private meetings and in the public session last week to clarify the budget implications of what is proposed. Ingalls Lyon indicated that the proposals were on schedule and on budget, yet in discussions over the last year or so, figures ranging from 18 to 20 million to what Ingalls Lyon referred to last week as 34.5 million have been bandied about. So I hear what the Cabinet Secretary says in terms of his assurances that all of this is within the envelope of the £48 million that was set. But given that, for example, primary radar was discounted as prohibitively expensive in the original survey, it wasn't in the original cost. I don't even think it's in the current estimates. What confidence can the public have that this is a project that remains on schedule and on budget?
Well, convener, I saw the evidence that was provided by HIAL last week, and they correctly referred to the capital budget as being £34.7 million. I'm also very conscious that there have been various figures bandied about in the press, which I'm afraid, from what I've seen, are wholly inaccurate, and I'm not entirely sure where some of them have originated from. So what I can say to you is that from the HIAL Board and the Project Management Board in taking the strategy forward, the project remains on time, due to be completed by 2027, with the rollout across a number of airports over the course of the next couple of years. And it remains within the budget, which was set back in December 2019. So I hear what Mr. McArthur's saying, but as it stands at the present moment in this project, there is no indication of any cost overruns. It is still within budget and is still operating to its original business case timeline. In relation to the matter regarding radar, I'm also conscious that this is an issue that was addressed by HIAL last week, where they set out the rationale for not taking forward the option of radar, principally on the basis that it deals with some of the surveillance issues, operational issues they have at airports. But what it doesn't address is it doesn't address the resilience issue. And the resilience issue is primarily around operational aspects related to air traffic control staff and the ability to have air traffic control staff that can cover more than one airport, only covering one at any given time, but the ability to be able to flex their staffing resource to cover other airports when is necessary. And that's the benefit they get from a centralised surveillance service. So the principal reason as to why it wasn't progressed and taken to business case is because the decision was made that the option set out in the Helios report, the one that most effectively addressed the range of issues that HIAL need to address and resolve, are the ATMS option. And that's why the business case was then developed and why the budget was then set for it.
It was also the option that Helios had identified as riskiest and costliest, was the remote towers option. So in a sense, each of the options would have an element of risk to it, but HIAL have chosen to go down the route of pursuing the one that is riskiest and costliest. They've also gone down the route of an option that builds in fairly significant single points of failure. They point repeatedly to the issue of staff recruitment and retention, and yet the issue where staff recruitment and retention is most problematic at the current time and has been over recent months is in relation to Inverness. So they're choosing to centre the entire operation in an area where recruitment and retention, the one of the principal drivers for taking forward this strategy, has been most problematic. And there is no answer to how, if you strip the roles out of island communities and communities like WIC, that you're not going to exacerbate the problem that HIAL is suggesting underlays the entire project.
Well, with any project of this nature, there are always significant risks attached to it. But there are, it's worth keeping in mind, is that I think to suggest that there is a potential risk of a single point of failure is, to some degree, with all respect, Mr. MacArthur, somewhat misleading, because you will be aware that the regulatory framework for any form of air traffic control system being introduced will require to have resilience within the system in order to deal with any single point of failure. Now, I'm not a technical expert, but my understanding, very often you need to have three different points at which to back up the system in order to ensure that any failure at a given point has actually got resilience in another part of the system to overcome that. So I think it would be wrong to give people the impression, not suggesting that you are, but I think it would be wholly wrong to give people the suggestion that this is a project that is based upon one system with one point that if it fails, the whole system goes down, when the regulator, the Civil Aviation Authority, will need to be satisfied that the resilience that's built into the system is sufficient to provide the cover that is required. So there is the regulator has the final and ultimate say in these matters in ensuring that there is not a single point of failure in the system. And as you go forward with the plan, as you would expect with a complex plan, as you put the various layers of that together, there are points that you need to check with the regulator to ensure that they are content with the measures you're putting in place to progress the project further. So I'm confident that a combination of the management board, the HIAL, alongside the overarching role that the regulator has in these matters, is that it will be a resilient system. Now, going back to your final point around that of the issues at Inverness, yes, there are recruitment issues at Inverness. However, there have been recruitment challenges across IAL's air traffic control system for many years. I'm sure that you will recall the challenges that they had, if I recall correctly, I think it was back in 2014, particularly in Stornoway, with issues around resilience and providing services, air services into Stornoway Airport, which were largely due to staffing issues. And one of the challenges that we put to HIAL is about making sure that as we move forward in the medium to long term, they can deliver sustainable long-term services, air services, into our island and remote communities. And that's a key challenge that we give them to take away and deliver. And this project is one that they believe will help to deliver that medium to long-term challenge in providing greater resilience and ensuring that we can maintain critical air services to our island and remote communities in the medium to long term within what is a changing environment, a changing regulatory environment in which they have to adapt.
I hear what you're saying, Cabinet Secretary, in relation to the issues around staffing in Stornoway. As I understand it, there were some very particular local circumstances there that perhaps had more of a bearing on that than anything else. What HIAL have failed to do is follow up the approach they took around about that time in terms of local recruitment, where in a sense that the approach that was taken in recruiting from the local communities had led to not only a demand for those roles, but then a continuation of people in those roles over a prolonged period. So when HIAL do what NHS Orkney have done, what Orkney Islands Council have done, what all the island authorities have done in terms of looking at local recruitment to maximise the chances of people remaining in those roles, it has proved as successful for HIAL as it has been for these other public sector bodies. Unfortunately, they've sought to go for a quick fix where they bring in ready-made qualified personnel who will have a short-term commitment to the organisation and then, not surprisingly, choose to leave. So HIAL are authors of their own downfall in baking in that lack of resilience in terms of staff recruitment and retention, I would argue. And in terms of the point of resilience, you're absolutely right in terms of the regulator role here, and CAA have made it abundantly clear that the radar and the tower option that HIAL were dismissing as not compliant with CAA regulations would indeed be a concept they would be quite happy to look at and would find acceptable. So HIAL have been putting up straw men throughout this process about options that were available to them that they have discounted, simply because this is a process that started from the basis that they wanted to go down the route of remote towers, and they have done everything in their power to backfill a justification for the approach that they've taken.
Well, I'm not sure. I'll deal with your second point, Mr. MacArthur, because I'll take the first point as largely being your opinion on the issue. But what I will say to you is that, if you look back at the history of this, is the HIAL have had an ongoing issue about making sure that they can maintain resilience across their air traffic network. And they need to also reflect on the changes, the regulatory changes, which they are likely to face in the medium to long term. Those issues will not go away. In commissioning the Helios report, which looked at these issues, the best option for addressing the issues that Highlands and Islands are facing, both in the medium to long term, is that the remote towers is the most appropriate model to pursue in order to address these issues. And I accept and recognise that the HIAL board have come to a position in viewing this as the most effective way in which to deliver that. I would also say that it's not a short-term project. This is a project which is going to be going on for several years. Its completion is due to be in 2027. So it is a long-term project, but it's important as we go forward with that, we try to address the issues that staff and communities have got around the project. So, for example, the work that they're doing around trying to develop a policy that would allow staff to commute to the control centres, and taking that forward in partnership with the unions, which I believe is with the unions to consider further, are all mechanisms that HIAL are trying to employ to assist staff in being able to remain engaged with the delivery of services. So clearly individuals will make individual decisions given their own personal circumstances, but HIAL have assured me that they're doing everything they can to try to help to support staff as part of this change, including the option of being able to commute to the remote towers once it's in place, to try and help to support them and be able to make the transition. But I I do recognise that for some staff it will create challenges for them, and it will lead them to make decisions where they may choose not to remain within the organisation, and that is to be regretted. But we need to also make sure that we are putting in place a system that will deliver medium to long term assurance around the delivery of air connectivity to our islands and remote communities.
Just one final question, Convener, just on that issue of jobs that are inevitably now going to be removed from Orkney and the other island communities. I'll have committed rather belatedly to an island impact assessment, but this is going to have no bearing on the fundamental decision that these are roles that are going to be taken out of island communities. Do you believe, Cabinet Secretary, that this reflects particularly well on the government's commitment to island proofing and to island impact assessments informing the decisions that government and public bodies take?
Well, it's worth keeping in mind is that the decision to take forward ATEMS predated the Islands Act, so there was no requirement for an Islands Impact Assessment to have been conducted. This has been applied on a retrospective basis to try and provide assurance around the approach that HIAL are undertaking, and I very much welcome that approach. But you'll also be aware that the purpose behind Island Impact Assessments is to understand the impact that a policy decision can have on islands community compared to that of a mainland community, and to identify the mitigations that can be put in place to try and address those issues. And that's what I would expect to come from this particular island impact assessment that's been taken forward. I think this may be the first island impact assessment that's actually been carried out, because at the time when it was commissioned, the guidance around the provision for island impact assessments was still being consulted on with local government colleagues. So I may be correct in saying this is the first of them, but the island impact assessment is not a gatekeeper to whether you do it or not. It is a process you go through to understand the impact it will have on island communities, and then to identify what mitigations you can put in place to address those issues. And that's what I'd expect to come from this particular island impact assessment.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Can I maybe ask just a couple of questions as well, Cabinet Secretary? Obviously, as has already been mentioned, there is a consensus that change is necessary, but not around what action has been taken. And HIAL has acknowledged that it's pursuing the most complex option. I wonder, given the risks involved, what assurance has HIAL provided to the Scottish Government about this project?
So the responsibility of HIAL is that they need to ensure that they can deliver safe, reliable, ongoing air connectivity to remote and rural communities. And as part of that, they need to make sure that they are taking expert advice on how they can provide that in a sustainable way going forward. Given the regulatory changes which they are facing around aspects of controlled airspace in the future, and also the resilience issues that they face on recruitment of staff and being able to be flexible with staff covering more than one airport as well, the approach that they've set out as part of this strategy is one that they believe will help to deliver that. So they've assured us that this is the most effective way that they can continue to sustain reliable air services in a safe way to our island and remote communities in the years ahead. So on the basis of that, we're content that this is the most effective means by which to deliver that in the future.
So you've been reassured there isn't really any risk?
Well, there's risk with everything, Convener, but they've assured us that they have a process in place where they believe that that risk can be effectively managed, not only through the oversight of their programme board and the oversight of the HIAL board, but also the independent oversight of the Civil Aviation Authority, who will ultimately be the final decision maker on the rollout of the programme itself to ensure that it meets their required safety measures. So there are several different layers of assessment that have to be carried out in dealing with any aspect of risk associated with this project that have to be considered. So there's a very robust process in place to deal with managing, identifying it and managing issues around risk that are associated with the project.
Also, the petitions have suggested that the improving local infrastructure, including radar, would be a preferable option. Did HIAL present other options for your consideration, or were you only presented with a strategy currently being pursued?
So, HIAL commissioned an independent Helios report setting out the challenges which they face, and it came back with the recommendations on the options that could be pursued in order to address these matters. I'm conscious last week in the evidence session you had with HIAL, they set out why they chose not to pursue the option of a radar-based system, largely on the basis that it does not address the resilience issues that they face going forward, whereas the ATMS option does address the resilience issues that they face in the years ahead. And on that basis, the ATMS option is the best option for delivering more resilience in the system going forward. So the option that was presented, or the option that's been taken forward, is based upon the expert advice that they've received is the most effective way to deal with the issues and challenges that they face in the years ahead.
You are aware that the Helios report that HIAL and yourself seem to be relying on said that the CAA wouldn't support radar in the tower, but in fact the CAA said yes, they could support that option. So you're relying on a report that's asserting something which the CAA says is not true.
Yeah, I think the point, as you heard from HIAL last week, was that they have chosen not to take the radar approach on the basis that it does not deal with one of the fundamental issues.
But you do accept that the Helios report was wrong in asserting that model couldn't be supported by the CAA. So it does question whether totally relying on the Helios report was wise.
Well, I'm afraid that I don't have the Helios report in front of me, but what I can say to you is that you will be aware from the evidence that you received from HIAL why they have not taken forward the radar approach, because it does not address the issue, one of the fundamental issues that they are trying to resolve, and that is to deliver greater resilience in their air traffic control system alongside meeting the regulatory changes that they will face in the years ahead.
I'm only highlighting the fact that you're relying on HIAL referring to a report which asserted something which simply wasn't true. But can I maybe ask just simply about the process in signing off the project? Can you just confirm that how does that work? And you would not have looked or interrogated the other options. You would be signing off what HIAL presented to you or not signing it off.
So this is by and large an operational matter for HIAL. So the process of decision making in this issue is for HIAL to commission the work that's necessary to address the issues that they've identified that need to be resolved to sustain air connectivity to our islands and remote communities in the years ahead, particularly in the medium to long term, alongside addressing potential regulatory changes which they would then face. And the decision on that is made by the board of HIAL. It's not made by ministers. So the decision
around it's only on subsidiary of the government, is that right?
Yeah, it's a public, that's correct, yes. It's a public board which is appointed by Scottish ministers. And like all public boards, they are able to make decisions on the basis of the responsibilities that ministers require them to make. And this is an example of a public board, HIAL, making a decision on how they can provide sustainable air traffic control services in the years ahead. It was not a decision that was made by ministers, it was a decision that was made by the HIAL board.
It's a pretty fundamental issue. but you have decided, you define that as an operational matter. But it is signed off by government ministers. In what circumstances would you not sign off the approach of HIAL, an initiative like this? Just to be clear, is the Scottish Government, is the ministerial just simply to say, this is what you present, we agree with it, or do you have a role in, if it is an I'm not clear where the operational matter and where it is a matter for government, where that division lies. So in signing it off, could you contemplate a set of circumstances where you would not sign it off, and what would that involve for you not to sign it off?
So this is probably a very good example, convener, of where ministers run the risk of being accused of interfering in the decision-making of public bodies that they appoint through their public appointment process, and then being called upon to interfere in that decision-making process when people don't like the decision which they have made. So the process, if it helps the committee, the process was that my predecessor back in December 2017 had a presentation alongside the board from Helios on the report and the findings from that. It's the responsibility of ministers to offer challenge to that. So question, is this the best option? What are the risks associated with it? What can we do to mitigate the risks? How will you manage it in taking it forward? Will you ensure that you adapt your plans if there are new and emerging issues that come forward? But based upon the recommendation of the board, then it is for the board then to take that matter forward. So ministers are there to offer challenge to our boards and who are appointed to the public appointment process. But you do run the risk of ministers interfering in the decision making of boards if we do not give them the scope to be able to make decisions on important issues. That's not to say we shouldn't challenge them and question them in these matters, but we also have to respect their responsibility in just discharging their role as having the oversight role for providing, in this case, air services to our island and remote communities.
Well, I have to say that I would need to reflect on what you've just said. It seems to me the scale of this project is very significant for communities. It's not really just a simple process. And can I ask you, one of the things we were told last week was that from the very beginning, it was clear that jobs would have to go from remote and island communities to Inverness. It was a centralisation of staffing. At what point, if at any point, did Scottish Government ministers look at that and say, that runs entirely counter to a strategy that wants to support and sustain good quality jobs in remote and island communities? I'm not talking about mitigating a decision that's maybe a bad decision. I'm asking if it's fundamental, which I think it is and I hope it is, to sustain remote and island communities through sustaining good quality jobs there. What was the reaction when the government was told from the beginning that this approach was predicated on centralising jobs in Inverness, and in a challenge role for ministers, did they at any point say, actually, if that's fundamentally what you're going to do, we need to look at this again because it runs entirely counter to our economic and social strategy for remote and island communities?
So a couple of things there. So that's the type of thing I would expect to have been challenged at the time and questioned at the time. And I'm sure that that was one of the challenges that was put to the board at the time. Keeping in mind that the responsibility that HIAL have is to maintain and sustain air connectivity to our island and remote communities in the years ahead. And we need to have a system that will help to support us in delivering that, and to do that in a sustainable way that is also resilient. So if we don't change, the risk is that we end up losing air connectivity to some of our remote and rural communities as a result of adapting to the challenges which we're facing and the regulatory changes that we're also facing. Now, the risk is that if we don't adapt and change to that, is that some of our remote and rural communities and island communities will be at an even greater disadvantage because we're not able to provide them with the air services that they deserve and they require to sustain and support people in these communities. So although we will always want to try and make sure that we take an approach that helps to encourage people to be able to live in our island communities, to move to our island communities, to have good quality jobs in these island communities, we also need to adapt to some of the changes and the challenges which we face. And this is a project which is an example of trying to do exactly that, trying to adapt to the changing regulatory framework and also the challenges which the service faces in the medium to long term. But to do that in a way that potentially minimises the need for individuals to no longer be able to live in island communities while providing the service. And an example of Highlands and Islands airports trying to address that issue is through the commuter policy that they are developing in partnership with the workforce and with the trade unions. So we can never, you know, we're never going to be in a position where we can say that no change will ever be necessary or that we'll be able to protect every single role of job that is on our island communities because change will have to happen. But what we have to do is try to mitigate against those as much as we can. And an example of that, again, is, for example, is the Pfizer Centre of Excellence that Highlands and Islands Airport are developing in Benbecula. Again, is another practical example of HIAL taking a proactive approach to helping to sustain and support good quality jobs in our island communities and to hopefully grow those jobs in the future. But at the same time, making sure that we have a system in place that allows us to sustain, maintain, and have reliable air connectivity to our remote and island communities. So it is a challenging balance, but it's an important one. And it's one that we need to make sure that we continue to work at trying to get right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think the issue is that the history and experience of island communities in Scotland has always been that there's been a necessity to centralise. It's always been too difficult to sustain the jobs in the island communities. And I have to say to you, I do find it depressing that the first thing that was said was that this would involve jobs being taken out of remote and rural areas. And there does not seem to have been pushback. And that, I think that is a fundamental problem. We know that HIAL's mission statement is to create social benefit and economic prosperity by building Scotland's sustainable regional airports group for the future. So social benefit and economic prosperity are of equal importance to sustainability. Were there other options? Did we look at, I mean, one of the points we made, and I wonder if you want to comment on this, that it appears that retention is higher in island and remote communities than if the jobs are located in Inverness. So it may not be that the question of staff retention has been a problem for the service as a whole, but it actually is disproportionately a challenge in Inverness. I wonder if that has been considered. And I wonder again, you say there needs to be a balance, but are you not concerned that the balance again has been towards taking jobs out of communities that won't be sustainable if these kinds of high quality jobs are retained?
The first thing I want to say is that I don't accept your assertion that there hasn't been pushback on the issue of the impact this will have on jobs in our island communities. I've just given you a number of examples of the challenge that we've put to the board that has resulted in them looking at trying to address some of these issues, whether it be the Faisal Centre of Excellence or whether it be the issue around a commuter policy. It's an issue that I've raised with the chair of the board in my regular meetings with them, is to make sure that they're doing everything they can to address the staff concerns and also the concerns that island stakeholders have, and to try and minimise some of those concerns as much as possible and to try and mitigate them where we can. So I don't accept the idea that there has been no challenge or pushback to the board. What there is, though, is there is also recognition that the status quo is not an option and that we need to address some of the fundamental issues that HIAL face in the years ahead. Those issues won't go away. We can't wish them away. We can't just want them not to be addressed. We have a responsibility for island communities and our remote communities to ensure that they can get the critical air services that they require. This is the issue around the skill sets that are necessary for some of these issues in our islands communities are not just, you know, particular to air traffic control. We have a similar problem in aspects of our health services for a number of different reasons, where we can't deliver services in island communities for a whole variety of regulatory reasons and challenge around staffing. It's the same in remote areas, but we need to try and take approaches that mitigate and manage these as effectively as we can. Specifically though, on your point around retention of staff, I'm conscious this is an issue which was raised with HIAL last week, and they sought to address that. My understanding is that they're going to provide the committee with some further details around the staff retention issue, but they did point out that on balance across their staffing levels is that their staff retention levels are significantly more challenging than other comparable organisations. And no doubt the information that will be provided by HIAL will be able to address specifically some of the staff retention issues that they have. But it's one of the factors that they are seeking to try and address as part of the ATMS strategy.
Thank you very much. And can I call Gail Ross?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and Gary Cox. I just wonder, the Convener talked about the board, and you rightly say that it's the board that make the decision, but we have had concerns raised that the board doesn't have any representation from people who live in remote, rural or indeed island communities. So are you satisfied that there's enough skills and expertise on the board to be able to make a decision of this magnitude?
I am confident they have the skill set to make a decision on this, and I'm also conscious that the chair has drawn in additional expertise to the board. They made representation to us and looking to increase their number of non-executive directors with a specialist skill set in IT and a change management, and we agreed to them increasing the board in order to accommodate that. So we've sought to make sure where they've highlighted issues that we can allow them to draw in additional expertise. If you forgive me, I'm not familiar with the where all of the board reside. I'd be more than happy to take that away and look at it. However, the board recruitment process is not based upon your point of residency. It's based upon the skill set that you have and what the board believes it requires in order to help to offer that challenge to the executive team at Highlands and Islands Airport. I try to meet with all of the individuals prior to them being appointed to boards such as HIAL. And one of the issues that they will always be asked about is issues around their understanding of the sensitivities of services to our island and remote communities, the sensitive nature of how they can be very fragile, and the need to make sure that the decision-making is reflective of some of the challenges that these communities have. So it's part of the recruitment process. The importance of serving our island and remote communities is an issue that they have to have a clear and proper understanding of. But the primary purpose of the role is the skill set they bring to the board. But if the committee convener would find it helpful, I'd be more than happy to check whether the board could provide more details on the residency of all of the board members.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, obviously, for data protection issues, we're not going to be pinpointing where they live. I was just wondering about the difference between having an understanding of a remote, rural or island community and actually having lived experience of it. I think that there is a marked difference. I want to touch on two other areas quickly, if I may. Both yourself and HIAL last week are putting quite a lot of emphasis on this commuter policy for the staff. And I just wonder what the feedback has been already on this, because I know from my own experience, and certainly I don't live on an island where it might be more difficult to commute, what that commute would look like, how it would be done, and how many of the staff are actually going to be willing to do it.
I'm afraid, Kavina, I can't provide you with that information because it would be a matter for HIAL, given the operational nature of it and also the ongoing engagement they're having with the unions. I'd be more than happy if it would assist Gail Ross to ask HIAL if they could provide some more specific details on how they intend the policy to work and also how they would also how the numbers of staff have indicated whether they are prepared to participate in it. It may be, in fairness to HIAL, too early to say how many staff are willing to participate in it, given that they are consulting, engaging with unions on the policy at the present moment. And it may be it will only be in the months ahead that we'll get a better understanding of how many staff would seek to make use of it. But I'm more than happy to take that away and to ask HIAL if they could provide some more specific information around this.
Okay, thank you. And my final question, convener, is about WIC Airport, you won't be surprised at, and the move to a FISO way of working. How's this going to work in with the current proposal for a PSO? And obviously, we've got oil traffic and wind farm traffic and other traffic going through WIC Airport. Will the FISO model be compatible with wanting to increase the amount of flights going in and out of WIC Airport? We spoke last week about the slot system, you know yourself about the problems that we have during the summertime with fog and things, and planes are delayed or cancelled altogether. So is the FISO model compatible with an aim to increase flights in and out of WIC Airport?
In short, yes. So it shouldn't hinder growth of air connectivity to WIC Airport. So it should allow services to be developed and move forward. I'm conscious of the challenges the airport's got just now and the funding we've provided for WIC to look at developing a PSO in partnership with the local authority and other local partners. So I fully understand and recognise the importance of the establishing air connectivity to WIC and the importance it has to the local community. But moving to a FISO approach, it should not change any of that at all. And one of the things that we do challenge the HIAL around is to make sure that in any remodelling of services, is that it does not act as a constraint on the growth of air connectivity or that it results in a reduction in air connectivity. It should allow existing air connectivity to be sustained and it should also provide sufficient capacity for future growth in the years ahead. And the approach that they're taking, including with WIC and also with Bimbecula, would allow that to continue even with the changes that they're having, the changes that they're taking around air traffic control at both airports.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you. David Torrance.
Convener, and good morning, Minister. HIAL has received Ireland's impact assessment that is commissioned and is being presented to HIAL Board today. By acknowledging that this project predicts Ireland's act, given its potential impact across islands, is the Scottish Government satisfied that HIAL is only made able to consider such an assessment now?
I'm sorry, I missed David Walter's last point, but I think it was around the Highland impact assessment and whether we're satisfied it's been carried out at this particular point in the process.
Cabinet Secretary, it was just that HIAL Board are only seeing it today. Is that acceptable? Are you confident that's okay?
Well, I think I would go back to the point I made to Liam MacArthur earlier on, and that is that the decision point in moving to an ATMS project was made back in January 2018. It predates the Islands Impact or the Islands Act and the requirement for an island's impact assessment. So there is no legal obligation for them to carry it out. In fact, in carrying it out on a retrospective basis, IAL could have carried it out internally, but in order to provide assurance that it was a robust process, they commissioned the work independently. So it's an independent consultant who has a track record in issues around the Highlands and Islands, who my understanding is a well-known individual in the Highlands and Islands, so has got sufficient expertise and understanding of the challenges in our island and remote communities. So they've commissioned someone independently to carry that out. And clearly, I think it's important to remember that Highlands impact assessments are not the gatekeeper on whether you do something or not. They are about assessing the impact that they will have compared to a mainland community, and then identifying what mitigations and actions you can take forward to try and address these issues that will have an impact on the island. And I would expect this island impact assessment to address some of those issues and to identify what some of those mitigations will be. And it will be it will then be for High Island and the board to set out how they will respond to some of those specific points within the within the assessment once they've had an opportunity to consider the report.
Thank you, Convener. I have no further questions. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for your answer.
Can I just confirm then that an island impact assessment would not be able to say this project should not be progressed because of the impact on local communities?
No, that's not the purpose of an island impact assessment. It is to assess impact and then to determine what mitigations could be in order to address it.
Okay, so even if the decision was going to be really damaging to a local community, what the impact assessment would be doing would be looking at how we can maybe address the consequences of that, but would never actually open up the decision about whether it was a wise decision or not. Can I call Maurice Corrie?
Convener, thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and Mr Cox. Strengthening resilience has been cited as a key reason for the project. Now, questions have been raised, however, about the resilience of recruitment and retention of air traffic control officers once centralised in Inverness. Is the Scottish Government confident about the resilience offered by this project, Cabinet Secretary?
You know, it's one of the primary purposes that the project has been taken forward to address issues around resilience. From a staffing point of view and also from a wider safety point of view as well, there are some of the safety provisions, and I want to just make this point, Convener, is that Highlands and Islands airports are very safe and operate to the regulatory standards that are necessary, but the ATMS system will provide additional resilience and greater safety provision as a result, because it will move into some airports that are not presently controlled airspace. It will become controlled airspace as a result. So from tackling issues around recruitment and resilience around recruitment, this project will assist us in addressing that, while at the same time it will provide greater safety margins and how the existing network operates as well.
Yeah, would Mr Cox like to make a comment?
Yeah, just to agree with the Cabinet Secretary's just to agree with the Cabinet Secretary's views there. I think the other aspect of this as well is that, you know, staff working in the new centre will be trained and working with the latest technology, with the latest air traffic control procedures, and that makes this, you know, an attractive proposition for people looking to develop their careers in air traffic control. So you know, at present, you know, the controllers within HIAL are you know, absolutely fantastic at what they do, but they are practicing a dying art to some extent in relation to the air traffic control procedures operated around HIAL. You know, that this opportunity here you know, makes it a much more attractive proposition, because HIAL will be in step with the broader air traffic control market around the world, working with the latest kit, the latest technology, and the latest procedure.
Can I ask a further question, Convener, on this point? During the evidence session last week, the committee heard that relatively few air traffic control officers are prepared to relocate to Inverness. Now, is it the Scottish Government's concern that Hywel will be losing so much institutional memory as a result of this centralisation? And also the comments of Mr Cox about a dying art is slightly strong, I think. Cabinet Secretary.
So you would have heard in the evidence last week is that what we don't want to do is we don't want to lose staff and the institutional memory, as you put it, that they have within the organisation. But we also need to make sure we modernise the system and that we have a system that is able to sustain services in the medium to long term. And that's why I think the mistake that some of the commentary out with this project around it, not saying the committee, but out with it at times has been as though this is a technical project. It's not. It's a change management project. It's changing the approach that's taken to delivering these critical services. So it brings risk and challenge with it for the staff, which needs to be managed in a very careful and pragmatic way, and also in an understanding way as well. And that's why the challenge that we've put to the board is to make sure that they're doing everything they can in engaging with staff to try and address their concerns where they can be reasonably addressed in order to support and assist them in their decision making and whether they want to move to the new system or whether they choose not to do so. And if staff choose not to do so, is to work with them to try and help to support them on what direction you want to go in the future. So I think at this stage, Mr Corey, it is probably, given the work that Hywel are taking forward to try and address some of the staff concerns around things like a commuter policy, etc., what the final outlook will be of staff is difficult to determine, and some of that may change as the project goes forward and people's views change of at that point. So what I've asked the board to make sure they're doing is to work very closely with the staff to try and address their concerns and to try and find ways in which they can meet some of the challenges that the staff are facing in a reasonable fashion in order to try and help to support recruitment and retention of the staff going forward with the change.
Maybe, Liz, thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. Maybe Mr Cox would like to comment in relation to retraining of those staff who make the move to stay and therefore need retraining and convert the dying art into, all right, the modern art. Mr Cox, your comments, please.
So, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the training is a huge part of this, and staff will need to make that transition from the current procedures into the new procedures, and that's built into the business case for this programme. I think the other element of it as well is, and you're coming back to what the Cabinet Secretary said about the Bibecula training facility for FISO staff. You know, that is another important element of it. But I think, you know, the key point is that, you know, that this is, you know, it's a hugely skilled occupation, as you know, and you know, there is a huge amount of training involved in the transition over to the new system, but also, you know, Bibecula and WIC in terms of the new procedures there. But you know, the training element of this is well set out in the business case. It features in the, you know, the programme board discussions. It features in the risk register. And you know, just jumping back to the Cabinet Secretary's point about the skills of the board, we do have non-executive board members with particular experience of transformational change and human resource factors within that. So their skill and experience is helping as part of the oversight of the programme in relation to training.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Tom Mason.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'm going to make a comment first. Does it not surprise you that we get so much difficulty in putting these sort of projects in position? If we go about the way we do it, the fact the impact assessment is coming in now, when major decisions have already been made, little wonder that people object to the process. And indeed, what happens if you can't mitigate against some of the issues? You're landing up with an imperfect project and one which is severely compromised in performance. And that is why we get so much problem, and probably because we get so much overrunning in projects because these things haven't been thought through from the beginning. And may I have your comment on that?
So the first point I would make is that, and it goes back to the point I made earlier on, Mr. Mason, and that is that the decision to move forward with this predates the Islands Act. So there was no requirement for an Islands Impact Assessment to be carried out in the first place. However, given the concerns that have been raised by local communities and community stakeholders, particularly in our Islands communities, the Highlands and Islands Airport Board agreed to take forward the commissioning of an Islands Impact Assessment to try and offer further reassurance around their determination to try and address the issues of concerns and also issues of concern, and also to try and mitigate some of the concerns and issues that the project results in. So I think it's, I wouldn't see it, and I think it'd be unfair to see the carrying out of the Island Impact Assessment now as a criticism of HIAL. They're actually doing something which they don't legally have to do because it wasn't required at a time when they made the decision. And they're applying it retrospectively to try and offer reassurance that they are looking at every aspect of the change in order to try and mitigate against some of the challenges which some of the communities have raised around this programme.
It may not be in HAL's remit to do so, but is it then should not that be in the remit of the government to consider these various issues, even if the Island Act was not in position? The issue still existed, and therefore should be addressed before the project was given the go ahead.
So one of the issues that was raised at the time is the issue around the impact that it has on island communities, and I think it'd be fair to say that HIAL are not waiting for the Island Impact Assessment to try and address some of these issues. So some of the challenge that we've put to them from the government side around this project is to make sure that they're addressing these issues and concerns. And we've already discussed this morning a couple of those issues. The FISOL Centre of Excellence that we're developing in Mimbecula, which will require additional staff recruitment for the running of that centre, and also the commuter policy which they're developing with the trade unions to support staff who work in islands communities. So I think it'd be wrong to suggest that HIAL are not, and that the Scottish Government have not challenged them on these issues, because we have. And in response to that, HIAL have taken forward a range of measures to try and address some of the concerns and issues that have been highlighted. What I would now expect through the Island Impact Assessment is that the issues that it identifies and the mitigations that it suggests, to then for HIAL to then suggest and how they can take these issues forward and how they can address these concerns further.
But what happens if they can't?
Well, I don't know what's in the report, so I don't know what will be within it. But what I can assure you of is that from the government's perspective, we will want to be assured that IAL are considering the suggestions in the report very seriously and very thoroughly, and that they consider what action they can take. But we're not at a point where we understand what exactly the detail of, I don't know what's in the report, so I can't comment on whether they're going to be able to do it or not. But we will be pressing them to make sure that they address the issues as effectively as they can.
Okay. Can I talk about budget for a moment? You outlined what the overall budget was, and you said there was a contingency within that sum of money, 6.8 million, I think, contingency, or 5.5 or whatever. And that was the contingency at the start of the budget process in 2019. How much headroom have you still got left in terms of the way the project is going? In other words, how much has been of that contingency has been allocated already? And how much spare have you got left?
I don't have that information to hand. HIAL would have to provide that through their programme board. But I'd be more than happy to take that away, Mr. Mason, and ask them if they could provide details on that. However, as you'll be aware, in any major infrastructure project, it's important that contingency is provided, because there will be issues that will arise during the course of a project. So the contingency that's been provided is not unusual. It's very normal for major infrastructure projects. I would expect, by and large, any use of that contingency to crystallise more clearly as the project matures, as you get further down the line of the project. And given that it's still at a fairly early stage, my expectation is that a very limited amount of that contingency, if any of it, will have been used at this stage. But I'm more than happy to ask Hyal if they can provide you with more details of that, if that would be helpful.
Yes, I think we need that, because at the moment people are concerned that the project costs, as many other project costs in Scotland have gone out, have spiralled out of control. Ferry is a typical example. So we don't want further projects taking place which spiral out of control. And control of contingency is an important part of that process.
Absolutely. It is an important part. But equally, there are many projects, major infrastructure projects in Scotland, which are delivered within budget and some even under budget. For example, the Queen's Ferry Crossing, which came in under budget. So good, robust project management and effective oversight of a project is critical to making sure it's effectively delivered. But major complex projects at times can have some financial challenges, but many projects are by and large delivered on budget.
As they should do. I mean, I'm from the construction industry myself, so I know exactly what's involved in budgetary control. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I call Rhoda Grant?
Thank you, Convener. Can you bear with me? I just have a number of things I want to raise. I think first and foremost, we need to put on record that nobody argues that change is not needed. Of course, the safety systems need to be upgraded. They need to be resilient and they need to be there going forward. But it seems that communities have been given a take it or leave it option, and they truly do not believe that the option being offered is the best option. And they would be willing, as would staff, to work with you to find the best option, because this option is going to do untold damage to the economy of the islands. And I think I need to make you very aware of that. I understand from your answers, Cabinet Secretary, that you're leaving a lot of this decision-making to Hyal, but can I urge you to take an interest, and can I maybe point out some of the questions that you should be asking them? Because ultimately, the buck stops with you. You have to sign this off, and it will be you that will be held responsible for it. Firstly, you talked about staffing and resilience, and this was the main reason for the move. Now, we understand that 30 to 60 of the staff will not move. So immediately you are in a recruitment nightmare. There is a cost attached to either redeploying them on their current salaries or making them redundant, and the cost of replacing them as well. Now, you've talked about the ability to commute. That was something I raised very early on. I was told by the project manager that wasn't an option because HMRC would not wear it. So therefore, the staff would have to start paying tax on the cost of their commuting flights and their accommodation. So that's not going to work at all. You also talked about issues going back in 2014. Can I just pay tribute to what Hyal did because of that? They actually recruited and trained local staff, and they actually then were able to retain those local staff. So where they recruited staff locally, trained them themselves, they stayed. They worked their whole working life with Hyal, and that recruitment issue was no longer an issue. What is an issue is where people are working, where they can then go and sell their skills elsewhere. So can I just ask you, what would you do if 60 staff refuse to move? What are the costs associated with that?
Well, look, let me try and deal with a number of the points that you've raised there. And some of the, I think it's probably still too early to say exactly what the final decision of staff will be. because the project is still at an early stage. So I think it would be wrong to make judgments on the basis of that at the present moment. But clearly, it's important for High Isle to continue to engage with their staff in order to try and address their concerns and to retain as many staff as possible. Can I go back though to your earlier point? And your earlier point is that we agree that change is necessary, that the status quo is not an option. The challenge here though is that for those who oppose this particular project is that if you look at the key issues that High Isle have set out that need to be addressed in order to sustain effective air connectivity in the medium to long term, no practical alternative solution has been identified. Mm-hmm. So some people would say what you could do is you could go to radar. Doesn't it deal with the resilience issue, which is one of the key issues that they need to have addressed, which is why it's important that we take forward an approach that will address the key points, the key issues that High Isle need to address in the medium to long term. And when you look at those issues, the most effective way to do that is through ATMS. It is the most effective means by which to address the issue. So we also need to recognise that the decision making on this was arrived at following a very detailed expert report that went through the various issues that High Isle are looking to address and to identify what the options are in seeking to address those issues. And as a result of that, ATMS is the most effective means by which to do that. And then from scrutiny of the board, their consideration is that that is the most effective means by which to deliver that and sustain these services in the future. So what I'm not going to do is I'm not going to go back to the decision that the board made in January 2018, for the very reason that we need change. We need to make sure that we're addressing these issues to ensure that we have medium to long term air connectivity to Isle's communities, and also for the reasons going back to the question just asked about by Mr. Mason, is that we have a project that has already been taken forward. The danger with many projects is that when it reaches the point where it starts to directly impact on individuals, or individuals have to make decisions, is that people then decide, well, I don't like that, and I don't want it to happen. And you start to this is the point I'm making, though. Let me finish the point I'm making, and that is that you're in danger of unpicking the project and all the financial and regulatory and practical difficulties that will come from that. So I accept there are challenges around the staff's view on some of these changes. That's why it's important that High Isle continue to engage with staff and their representatives to address these matters as effectively as they can.
Cabinet Secretary, your answer to me was that the alternative of radar was not considered a resilience issue, that the top resilience issue is staffing. The move to centralisation is going to affect staffing and you're going to lose staff. So therefore, radar to the tower has been discounted based on the wrong information and wasn't considered in the expert Helios report. So I think we need to go back and look at that. Can I just also address another point of resilience? You talked in your own evidence about three points of resilience with connectivity. Now, each of those island airports have one point of resilience. So if that goes down, there is no resilience. The cost of supplying two points of connectivity is not included in the price at the moment. And the standards that we should be attaining are the ones that you yourself pointed out as three points of resilience. So if that resilience cannot be found, the CAA will not approve the scheme. So therefore, spending to date will have been wasted. Is that not true?
Well, as you heard from the evidence from High Isle last week, is that they believe they can deliver on the connectivity that would be necessary for the project to be delivered. And what will happen is, with any project, is as I mentioned earlier on, there is a various layers that you will go through in developing your project that will involve engaging with the regulator to seek their assurance that they are satisfied with the measures that they are taking forward are sufficient to meet their regulatory standards. So that would crystallise at an early stage in the process. So, and I know that HIAL also commissioned an expert report on communications and connectivity as part of this project. So I'm confident they will be able to address these issues, and the board and the project team are well aware of the issues associated with that. So there is that's already part of their planning and their thinking, and will be part of any regulatory oversight before the project, before the actual system can go live.
But you don't know how much that will cost. And given the cost of the Highlands and Islands broadband programme, that could run to many millions.
Well, the project cost is met within the existing project cost itself. So the cost to that would have to be met within the actual overall budget that's set at the present moment. That's it. Their business case is predicated on the basis of what they believe and understand that they need to deliver for connectivity. And the project is based on that. And out of interest, for example, when you mentioned, for example, digital connectivity, I think it's something like 15 subsea cables alone will be laid for the purposes of the R100 programme to our island communities to help to provide them with greater and better connectivity. So, as I said,
I'll
bring
you back in, Rhoda, in a minute. Rhoda?
Okay. Can we turn to costs? And this is an issue of concern. The original 2018 Helios report quoted a cost of 18 million. We are now being quoted a cost of 48.4 million. And that is even before we have costed the cost of putting in the other points of resilience with regard to connectivity. And those costs are based on the untested ADSB system, which the CAA may reject. So I wonder what you think that the final cost is going to be.
Well, I'm sorry. I think this is part of the confusion around these figures. The £18 million figure in the Helios report is not the cost of delivering the ATMS project. It's the additional costs of implementation of a remote towers and central approach surveillance solution. The overall cost for the whole project is £48.4 million. That's what was put forward originally at the board in December 2019, and it remains the budget. The budget has not changed. The cost has not increased. The budget remains on target for the delivery of the project. The only change it was made when it went to the Transport Scotland major projects board was that the level of contingency was increased because it was viewed as being too low and not in line with what would normally be provided for within a major project. The budget remains the same and it has not increased.
Well, it has apparently increased, but I will leave that apart. Maybe you can tell me where in the budget is the cost of providing the additional points of resilience and providing direct surveillance if the CAA insist on that.
Well, the first thing is, I'm sorry, but you are simply wrong in that the project costs have not increased. The budget is £48.4 million and it remains £48.4 million. That was a figure that was agreed at the time when the project was approved. To suggest that it has increased is wrong and is not accurate. However, specifically on the costs for individual elements of the project, we would have to ask HIAL to provide you with that. So if you want specific details on any additional communication or connectivity issues that they're addressing through the course of the project, they would have to provide that, because that would be held by the project team, with the HIAL board having oversight of it. But I'd be more than happy if it would help Rhoda Grant to ask them to provide that information if it's presently available for them.
I would want that information, but I'm astonished that you, as the person that has to sign this off, is not interested in obtaining that information for himself. Can I turn to the downgrading of Wickham Benbecula? You said to Gail Ross that this would have no impact on flights in or out of Wick or Benbecula at any point. My understanding is that the downgrading will mean that flights need to be 2 hours apart, and therefore that allows for 4 flights a day. When Wick Airport was being used as resilience for the oil industry, there was a lot more than 4 flights a day. When Benbecula will be used as part of the MOD work at Kinetic, there will be a lot more than 4 flights a day. Are they going to lose that work, or are you going to put contingencies in place to allow that kind of work to continue? Because that is a huge economic impact on those areas.
So let me firstly deal with your incorrect assertion at the start of your comments there, in that I'm not interested in what the cost of some aspects of this project are. The first thing is that, one, you've been wrong on the cost of the budget increasing. It hasn't. It is still within the business plan, as was set out. Secondly, ministers are not managing the project on a day-to-day basis. I'm sure you appreciate that major infrastructure projects are not managed on that basis. Project boards are set up specifically to deliver that. If there was issues around the costs that would then have an impact on the budget that had been agreed overall for the project, then clearly that's an issue that would be highlighted to ministers. Right now, the project board, HIAL, the HIAL board, are clear that the project is on budget and it's on time. That's a fact, and that's a reality of the situation. If that is not the case, then clearly, as the minister responsible for services that HIAL provide, I will want to know why that is not the case, or if it is the case, and why and what action is going to be taken in order to address any of these issues. That's a matter of process, just to make sure the member has been accurate in a reflection of ministerial interest in these matters. The second point I'd make is that you heard an evidence last week from HIAL about the impact that the changes would have on places like Benbecula and Wick. And from their perspective, it will not result in a reduction in services to these airports. It will also provide capacity for an increase. I think, if I recall correctly, in the evidence that was provided, I may be wrong here, but I think they said even if you were to go on the basis of a slot system, is that there was still something like almost 60% of the slots available that could be provided. I may be inaccurate in that, but if I recall correctly, I think I heard them making that point.
And
so they
possibly made that point, but you need to bear in mind the amount of cancellations of flights due to COVID-19. Wick has not been handling the oil traffic at the moment, and there, as far as I know, have been no manoeuvres at the Kinetic range at the moment. So that their assertion last week doesn't take account of the issues I'm putting to you today.
Well, I'm aware that these are both airports that have a very low level of flights over the course of a period of time. But as you heard from HIAL last week, is that they believe that the change in the system will not have an impact on any service reduction, and that they'll be able to sustain existing services and also for increased demand going forward, should and when that arises.
They said they were still in talks with Kinetics, so they didn't know if that was going to impact on Kinetics dealings or not.
I think if I recall correctly, again, I may be wrong here, but they were talking about some of the mitigation measures that they were looking to put in place around the introduction of the ATMS system. It was the engagement they were having with Kinetics.
No, it was about how it would impact on their work in Benbecula. I can't impress on you enough that you should be taking a very close interest in this, because it will be you that is held responsible. You've presided over the ferries fiasco. This is going to be another fiasco. I don't think any politician, any cabinet minister wants to be blamed for the economic damage that this is going to cause. So I wonder, given that you will ultimately sign this off, and I make this plea to you, that you go back to HIAL and ask them to stress test the radar to tower option to see if that is an option. I think if people clearly saw that both systems were being compared and contrasted, both for resilience, safety, and for economic impact, they would sit a lot happier with the process that is being proposed. We truly believe it is the wrong process. It is damaging, it won't provide the resilience that is required, and it will have an impact on our island communities that you won't be able to unpick or put right. So I put that to you as a final statement in this evidence session, but I would urge you to go and reflect on it and think about it.
What I would say on your statement is that the decision was made back in January 2018 to progress with the ATMS model. That's the agreed project that's been taken forward. What I think would be reckless would be for us not to consider the challenges that HIAL face in the medium to long term around delivering sustainable, reliable, resilient air services to our remote and rural communities. And notwithstanding the challenges that they face in taking forward this particular project, it'd be irresponsible for any minister to ignore those factors and to simply put off making a decision around how we can ensure that long-term sustainable air services continue to be provided to our island communities in a safe and resilient way. And going from the expert advice that's been provided to HIAL, it's very clear that the ATMS model is the most effective way to deliver sustainable air services to our Highlands and Islands airports in the years ahead, and to ensure that they also comply with the regulatory framework which is necessary. But I understand that the ministers and the we have to make difficult decisions as part of our responsibilities, but we also shouldn't shy away from the need to make sure that we have the right protections and the right systems in place to sustain these services in the future. And HIAL have given us assurances on the basis of the expert opinion and advice that they have received is that this is the most effective means in which to do that. And that's why we support them in the project that they're taking forward and overall scrutiny of that project to ensure that it delivers on the objectives that it is intended to deliver, and that it also complies with the regulatory standards set by the Civil Aviation Authority.
I have no further question.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary? I do think that what we have heard does suggest that this needs to be looked at very closely, and I am personally concerned that there's a reliance on a report which some people have already identified having some weaknesses in it, and there doesn't seem to me to be built into the budget factors that are now developing around the further resilience that's required. And I would just hope that the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary, would keep his mind open and be asking the hard questions, because simply for HIAL to say they believe that the budget will not overrun, or they believe this is the best, is clearly not sufficient when it will have a massive impact. But I do appreciate very much the time that the Cabinet Secretary has taken, we now have to take a decision on what we do with this petition. I'm conscious of time, and I will let anybody in who wants to make a comment on how we should take this petition forward. My own view is that we have not really, as a committee, concluded a view on the petition. I think there's a recognition that there are very significant issues here. My own sense is that we, as a committee, as we reach the end of our time, will not be able to address all of this. But I do think this is something that a future Public Petitions Committee should be considering looking at further. And I would hope that we could include it in our legacy paper, but I'm interested in what other members may want to say. And I'll call Gail Ross.
Thanks, Convener. I'm glad that you made that suggestion, because that was the one that I was going to make as well. I would say that as a committee member, but also as a constituency member, I would like to see this continued, because I certainly don't think we're at the end of it today. I think that we should continue this in the legacy paper, along with a suggestion to take any updates from the Scottish Government to any areas of concern that have been raised today. And I'd also like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and Mr Cox for their evidence. Thank you.
I'm not seeing anybody else who wants to come in. In that case, I think we are recognising there are significant issues here, and indeed I think the Cabinet Secretary has said that I think maybe we could ask the clerks to go back through what was discussed today. There was a number of issues where there was questions asked. We were looking for further information. It would be helpful to have that, and we would I think be agreeing we want this to be in a legacy paper. And you know, the whole question of big projects and the needs of remote and rural communities, I think, are very alive to the committee in looking at this. But can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and Mr Cox for attending? Can I thank colleagues and the broadcasting team? I'm now going to move into private session and remind colleagues that they should rejoin us on Teams. Thank you very much.